What's good, it's your boy 2K here. Shout out to the movement and everybody who's moving with us. Man, I hate to play this whole Monday morning quarterback thing, and I meant to do a video before this fight actually happened, but your boy was working on Three Kings boxing shit, and I was working on shit for the movement. You know what I'm saying? We're really trying to make this happen. And I wanted to put y'all on notice about my man Jerwin Ancajas. Dude is a beast. This is the thing, man. Jamie Conlan is good. He's a good fighter. But, and I say this a lot, and y'all can get mad if you want to, but UK fighters are typically second tier fighters. You know what I'm saying? And Jamie Conlan's just another one. He looks really good on the UK circuit, but when they get to the world level, they get washed. You know what I'm saying? Even some of the world champions, just because they win a belt doesn't mean that they're on the world level. It all depends on who they fought and beat to get that belt, right? Prime example, Liam Smith. He was the WBO junior middleweight champion, and he defeated that motherfucking dude that was the coach for the Georgetown Hoyas by the name of John Thompson. You know what I'm saying? He defeated him, right? Nobody knew who John Thompson was, but he got a vacant title. Came over to the U.S., fought Canelo, and was thoroughly embarrassed en route to getting knocked out by a body shot. So what happened right after that? He went right back to the U.K. level and had two wars with a cat by the name of Liam Williams, another domestic U.K. second-tier motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? So that's case in point right there. He got a belt. He got on the world stage. Tried to defend his title on the world stage for the first time and got completely washed, only to go back to the domestic level. You see what I'm saying? Another guy, Anthony Crolla, sitting over there in, on the domestic level beating motherfuckers, right? You got a cat that was on like a year layoff. I can't remember how long Jorge Linares' layoff was, right? But gets in a ring and easily beats this dude, takes his belt. You know what I'm saying? Then they rematched. For whatever fucking reason. I mean, it was easy money for Linares. And Linares knocked him out in the rematch. You know what I'm saying? Easy work. And this is a guy that a lot of UK people want to say was on the world level just because he had a belt. And even Ring Magazine had this motherfucker ranked like number 3. You know what I'm saying? Come on, man. You know? I'll give you examples of UK fighters that are actually on the world level. Anthony Joshua, world level, right? Carl Frampton, even though I don't like his ass, world level, right? Kell Brook, you know what I'm saying? World level, right? Cal Yafai, 115-pound champion, world level. You know what I'm saying? Those guys are world level. Lee Selby, not sure. You know what I'm saying? Even though I like Lee Selby a lot, I gotta be honest. You know what I'm saying? This is a non-biased channel. He has a lot of flaws in his game to where I don't think he can fuck with the Gary Russells, the Oscar Valdezes of the 126-pound division. Billy Ho, you know what I'm saying? I still think he's a B-level fighter. He's going to fight David Lemieux, and that will be a good little barometer. You know what I'm saying? We can measure whether or not he's really world level or domestic level, depending on how he beats David Lemieux. He looked like shit against Willie Monroe, one of our B-level fighters. You know what I'm saying? A fight in which, if that fight was in the States, probably could have went to Willie Monroe. Could have been a draw. Yeah, I don't think Billy Ho is on the world level, but those other guys I mentioned definitely are. But that's my point. The majority of UK fighters are second-tier, domestic-level type of fighters that don't look good on the world stage. And this was just another example. Now, a lot of cats were saying Jamie Conlan, you know, 19-0, 11 knockouts, brother of Michael Conlan, the guy that got robbed in the Olympics by that Russian dude, you know what I'm saying? But Michael Conlan has a lot more pub than Jamie Conlan, and it's because of what happened in the Olympics. And to be honest with you, Michael Conlan's a better fighter than Jamie, even though Jamie's the older brother. Actually, Michael Conlan versus Jerwin Ancajas would have been a better fight, real talk, even at this stage of Michael Conlan's career. You know what I'm saying? But like I said, man, he's a good domestic fighter. But I knew, as well as everybody I fuck with in the movement, we all knew Jerwin Ancajas was that dude, or is that dude. I was turned on to Jerwin Ancajas years ago. I thought he was a good fighter, but I thought he had a stiff test last year against Miguel Arroyo. I thought he was going to lose that fight. I can't remember who the subscriber was that hit me up. You know what I'm saying? My bad that I can't remember you. If you're listening to this video, go ahead and tell me if you're the one that said this to me in the comment section. But I was talking to one of my subscribers and I said, man, I think, you know, when that fight was announced, I said, I think Miguel Arroyo got this fight. At that time, Arroyo was 15-0 and he was the IBF champion. Now, don't get this guy confused with the other Arroyo that gave Roman Gonzalez some trouble before he moved up to 115 pounds. That guy is Mick Williams Arroyo. Mick Joe and Mick Williams are twin brothers. And to be honest with you, Mick Williams is the worst of the two brothers. You know what I'm saying? I thought Mick Joe could beat Roman Gonzalez. You know what I'm saying? That's how good that I felt Mick Joe Arroyo was at that time. So I'm telling my subscriber, I'm like, man, I think Mick Joe is going to take it. He's the IBF champion. I like Ancajas. He's got that nickname, Little Pacquiao, that a lot of people like to dub him with because of his high work rate. But I just feel that Miguel Arroyo is going to beat him. Complete opposite. Jerwin Ancajas not only outclassed Miguel Arroyo, he took his belt from him, and he's now defended it 3 times. Very good fighter. He's putting 115-pound division on notice. I think Ring Magazine has him ranked number 6, which when you look at the 115-pound division, even though he's a very good fighter, that might be somewhat correct. Because that division, in my opinion, is the hottest division in boxing, right? I used to think that the hottest division in boxing was 154, junior middleweight. But now, as I look at, you know, the 115-pound division, I'm starting to believe that that is truly the toughest division in boxing. And you really got to watch boxing, you know what I'm saying? You got to pay attention to the little guys to understand where I'm coming from, you know what I mean? But, I'll do another video where I break that division down. I don't want to do that in this video. I just kind of want to go into this fight. Man, it was a mismatch on paper, and it was a mismatch in the ring. From round 1 all the way to round 6 when the knockout happened, Jerwin Ancajas was beating this motherfucker's body up, man. Just the way I like it. It's exactly how I used to fight when I was in the amateurs. I love cats that go to the body, man. Chop the fucking tree down. He don't even have to be... You know, people call a tree a tall fighter. He don't even have to be a tall fighter. Just put water in the tank, as Teddy Atlas would say. You know what I'm saying? And eventually that car is going to stop. And that's exactly what Ancajas was doing, man. He knocked him down with a body shot, which was a delayed reaction from Jamie Conlan. And a lot of people thought he was injured, but it was really a body shot. Motherfucker, he felt it, kept going and said, oh, shit, nigga, hold up. Time out, fam, time out. That's exactly what happened. You know what I'm saying? I think he dropped him again in the third round. Dropped him in the fourth. 3 body shots. Now, that's something you don't really see very often. And Jamie Conlan had heart. I got to give him that. You know, most cats, if they get dropped by a body shot 1 time and they get back up and they get dropped by it again, fight's over. You know what I'm saying? They're not trying to feel that shit again. Some cats go down from 1 body shot, say, fuck it, I'm done. Most recently, Josh Taylor versus my man Miguel Vasquez. I thought Miguel Vasquez was going to win that fight. You know what I'm saying? I didn't make a prediction or nothing. I just liked Miguel Vasquez a lot. And I wasn't too really big on Josh Taylor. Now I am. Nice body shot to the liver. Put Miguel Vasquez down. Josh Taylor became the first guy to knock Miguel Vasquez out. And that's with Miguel Vasquez fighting Canelo twice. So... But anyway, that's a perfect example of a guy that gets hit to the body and says, fuck it, I'm done, right? Well, he hit Jamie Conlan on 3 separate occasions to the body and knocked him down, and he still got up. It wasn't until the 6th round where it was a right hook to the head that actually got the fight stopped by the referee. And if the referee didn't jump in, I'm pretty sure Jamie Conlan still would have got back up. You know what I'm saying? That's that heart of the Irish motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Man, I had an Irish friend in college, man. This motherfucker, we get in brawls and shit. This nigga taking shots to the dome, man, and still getting up. You know what I'm saying? He used to get his ass whooped, but I used to fuck with him because he would always fight no matter what. And he whooped his share of ass. But he will get his ass whooped too. You know what I'm saying? But that's what the Irish have, man. They have a lot of heart. And they will keep coming. You know what I'm saying? Until the fight is stopped, right? As I mentioned, this fight was a complete mismatch on paper. And it showed in the ring. It also showed how, like I said, British fighters are really just second-tier fighters. We got to stop hyping these guys up until they actually step in the ring with somebody and beat somebody. Like Cal Yafai, for example. They didn't really hype Cal Yafai up that much. I don't even remember hearing too much about Cal Yafai. But when he beat Luis Concepcion, that's when you're able to say, yeah, that guy is good. You know what I'm saying? Because Luis Concepcion is somebody that has given a lot of guys at a from shit 112 to 115 a lot of trouble. He's given a lot of guys trouble. I think he had just gave Kohei Kano trouble right before that fight. You know what I'm saying? Kohei Kano, a real respected former champion, right? He had just gave him trouble and then went in there against Cal Yafai and got completely dusted. Motherfucker probably lost every single round, and it wasn't home cooking. He literally lost every single round. So when the UK fighters are doing shit like that, then it's okay to say, yeah, he just beat a very respectable fighter on the world level. He's the real deal. Ryan Burnett is another one. I thought he looked like shit against Lee Haskins, but then he beat my man ZZ Top, same dude that made Rau'shee Warren move down to 115 from 118. Beat the shit out of ZZ Top. Ryan Burnett is world level now. You see what I'm saying? So we got to stop hyping these fighters up, man, and we got to do better of assessing skills in the ring. There was a fight that I watched that led me to believe that Jamie Conlan was going to lose to Jerwin Ancajas. It actually, my first prediction that I made on the Movement Boxing Podcast, I said Ancajas would win a unanimous decision, an easy unanimous decision. But then I went back and watched a fight that Jamie Conlan had recently. It was last year. And it was a fucking barn burner. It was against fellow countryman Anthony Nelson. Now, he was getting his motherfucking ass whooped against Anthony Nelson. And all my UK cats that are watching this, y'all know who I'm talking about. Y'all saw that fight. Anthony Nelson was fucking this kid up. And I think Conlan ended up getting a KO in the eighth round. I'm not looking at his box right, but I think he got a KO in the eighth round. And that pretty much helped him. He landed a good shot. And I think it was a body shot, if I'm not mistaken. And it kept him on the ground. Another example of the body shot keeping motherfuckers on the ground, right? But that fight was literally back and forth. And I think Jamie Conlan was down twice in that fight, if I'm not mistaken. So, I mean, it was watching that fight, looking at Anthony Nelson, right, and understanding that Nelson is nowhere near the level of an Ancajas, and Jamie Conlan is really the same fighter he was last year. I changed my prediction from easy 12-round UD victory for Ancajas to fifth-round knockout. I was off by one round. You know what I'm saying? It is what it is. Again, just like Zolani Tete and Naoya Inoue, you know, Ken Shiro, Dago Higa, you know what I'm saying, Cal Yafai, and many other little guys, right, that I want you to take notice on. Take notice of Jerwin Ancajas, and he's actually calling motherfuckers out. Most recently, he's saying he wants the top dog at 115. And you know who that is. And it's not Juan Francisco Estrada. It's Naoya Inoue. That's the fight he wants. Man, if that fight happens, that is a motherfucking excellent fight that a nigga like me, I won't go to work for it. You know what I'm saying? Because that fight will probably be in Japan. And those Japanese fights and shit, they start at like 8 in the morning and shit over here. And they be on like weekdays sometimes and shit. Bro, I'll be at the crib watching that shit. You know what I'm saying? Real talk. YouTube, do what you do in the comment section. Be real. Tell me what you think about Jerwin Ancajas. And if you haven't watched them, I recommend you go check them out. This is real talk for real fans. One.